Okay, so I think we can start now, Swapna.
Yes, we can begin now.
So everyone, please pin yourself to KittuKate Lab so you can see the presentation.
Ma'am, I can't see it.
Yeah, wait, ma'am is still getting it on. Wait, hold on.
Mama still can't see anything.
Yeah, I think ma'am
Mama,
must be having some
I can see it. I can see it very
clearly. Mama, I can see it. Mama, I can see it.
Oh yes, yes, you can see it. I think.
Ma'am, first you have to pin and then unpin. Ma'am, first you have to unpin and then pin, ma'am.
Is everyone able to see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, so then we'll just begin. In a minute, we'll just begin.
Ma'am, we can also change the layout and put the and put it on spotlight, so we can only see the.
Sorry, what did you say?
Ma'am, we can also pin. We can also change the layout and put it on spotlight, so everyone can only see the presentation.
Okay. Okay, so then we will start with the presentation. So last week we had begun with studying what is element compounds and mixtures, right? So what is elements? Elements are the building blocks of life. Elements are the ones that we have that is found in the nature. Till now we know 118 elements. The elements can be in either atomic form or they could be in the molecular form also. Are available in nature. Some of them are available singly, just as atoms. Some of them are available in nature as molecules. For example, if I say sodium, sodium is naturally available as sodium chloride. So it is available as single Na. So we say it will be in the atomic form. If I consider oxygen, then oxygen is available in O2 form. So that will be, it will be present in the molecular form. So we say that elements can be present in atomic form or molecular form. There are 118 elements that we know up till now. Now, when these different types of atoms combine. I'm saying different types, okay? So when these different elements are combining, they are combining to form compounds. So like I gave you example of sodium chloride. Sodium chloride is NaCl. So there are two different types of elements. Sodium is also there and chlorine is also there. So it will become a compound. Water has got H2O. So water will have H also and O also. So again, it is a compound. I told you the compound formula will remain same wherever you go in the universe. In the entire universe, when they are trying to find out whether water is available on any planet, in any part of the universe, They're trying to find out water as formula H2 only. Not that on Earth we are finding water as formula H2O, and on some other planet we are finding the water as formula H2O2. Okay? So the compounds are universal everywhere in the, let's say we say it's universal. It's same everywhere. Okay? And then we studied about mixture.
Ma'am, what is sodium bicarbonate?
What? NaHCO3. Yes, ma'am, but that's baking soda or washing soda? Baking soda. Washing soda is Na2CO3. Okay. Now we'll go to mixtures. Can we go to next slide? We go to mixtures. In the mixtures, we saw that there are two types of mixtures, homogeneous and heterogeneous. When I say homogeneous mixtures, I mean that in the mixtures, they are not chemically combining. So they are not combining together. So they, it is not happening like how, like if supposing Na and Cl is there and they both are present. So both of them are in a compound, in a fixed ratio. If supposing I have just mixed iron and I have taken some other metal like copper, for example, I have mixed iron and copper. So when I'm just mixing both of these metals, I am not mixing them chemically. They are just combining probably because they have melted and they have formed together an alloy. Okay, so those things will be called as homogeneous mixtures, where the mixture looks as if example brass alloys we have. Huh?
Mom, I can't hear you.
Am I not audible to everyone?
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Ma'am, I can hear you.
Your voice is breaking, Farida. Yeah, yeah.
Ma'am, your voice is clear, but just can you speak a little louder?
Now is it breaking?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. So okay, so we spoke about homogeneous mixtures, where it is a mixture of two or more things. So if supposing you're making sherbet, okay, so if you're making sherbet, you're going to add the syrup, you will add water, and you may also add more sugar to it also, because you want to make it more sweeter. So it's a mixture of two or more things. You will not come to know that it is actually a mixture of two or more things, but it looks it is one. So that's why we call it as homogeneous. Homo means same. Now hetero is when you really come to know that they are different. So heterogeneous will be when you come to know that if supposing I have a mixture of soil, so that soil will be a mixture of so many things, no? Soil is a mixture of mud. It is a mixture of all the dead plant parts you can see. Sometimes you can also see parts of animals. Would be a heterogeneous mixture. Yes.
Mom, your voice was breaking in between.
Yes, ma'am, your voice is breaking in between.
Okay, wait, just let me log out. I'll log in again.
Okay. Am I now audible? Is it audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
that's
ma'am.
Better.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. You're audible
everything
now.
Everything is a composition, then we are also composed of something. Right? So, what are we composed of?
What are we composed of? All the atoms. Carbon,
ma'am, again your voice is breaking.
Ma'am, now I can't even hear you.
Ma'am, I can't hear you.
Even I have still not spoken. Now am I okay?
Yes, ma'am, a little bit.
Yes, ma'am. You're audible.
Ma'am,
you're audible.
Is it little bit or is it normal? Like every time?
Ma'am, it's normal. Ma'am, it's normal.
Ma'am, it's normal.
Okay.
Yeah. Ma'am, it's normal now.
Okay. So now can we continue without any breaks?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we have got homogeneous mixtures. Homogeneous mixture is where we don't come to know. Homogeneous mixture is where we don't come to know, and heterogeneous mixtures is where we come to know that the mixture is there. Okay, this is what we had done last class. I just did a brief up of that. Now we said mixtures are just combining. They are not chemically combining. They are just physically combining. So if the mixtures are physically combining, we can very easily separate the components. We can very easily come to know how to do methods and get them separated out. So on that point, we are going to have the entire session today. Okay. Before that, let's go to the next slide. Yes.
Excuse me, ma'am. So in a mixture, there's no chemical bond between the atoms or the molecules, whereas in a pure substance, there are chemical bonds in a compound.
Yes. So in a pure substance, there will be a chemical bond. In a mixture, there will be no chemical bonding. It will be probably just two things are like how I had explained you the mixing process. That is, supposing I'm mixing salt in water, what is happening to the salt? It is just going and sitting in the places in between the water gaps, in between the intermolecular gaps of H2O. They're just sitting there. That's it. Okay. Very easily you can separate water and salt. Very easily you can do that. So we again prove that mixtures is only a physical bonding. It is not a chemical bonding. And so separation of mixtures would be very, very easy. Now, what methods and why to separate it by which method is what we are going to discuss today. Yes, clear. So, general properties of water, general properties of mixtures. In mixtures, the properties of the compounds will remain the same. They don't change. Okay, they are not going to change. So, if I'm mixing iron and if I'm mixing copper, for example, whatever properties of iron is there, iron is very magnetic in nature. It can get attracted to any type of a magnet. So that will remain as it is. And copper is a good conductor of heat. It will also remain as a good conductor of heat. That will not change for copper. Correct? So when I'm doing just a physical mixture, it is not going to change the physical properties of the compounds. Yes, if I had done them, if I had made a compound, so then what would happen is that the properties would change. I'll give you one very good example of that for you all to understand. Last time I had spoken about sodium. I had told sodium is the most reactive metal that we know up till now.
Yes, ma'am.
And sodium has to be kept under kerosene so that it does not react with air and blast up. Right?
and chlorine. Chlorine gas I'm talking, okay? I'm not talking about chlorine liquid. Chlorine gas is Cl2. That chlorine gas is very, very poisonous in nature. It is greenish color gas. It is very poisonous in nature. Now, if you go to see sodium and chlorine, right, separately, they are very dangerous. Sodium is also dangerous and chlorine is also dangerous. But when they are combining chemically, when there's a chemical bond formed between them, what do we form? We form NaCl. And that we are consuming happily every day. Without that, we can't live.
Well, it's salt, right?
It is a common salt, yes, which we have found with common table salt. So to say that if supposing you are forming a compound, the properties of the metals and non-metals and elements totally change. They totally change. Another example, water. It is made up of hydrogen and oxygen. Hydrogen is H2 gas. Oxygen is also O2 gas.
Yes,
but when they are combining, they are becoming H2O, which is becoming a liquid. In liquid, right? So when you chemically combine, the properties will change. But when you only physically combine, the properties will never change of the compound.
Ma'am, like you just now said that chlorine is very dangerous in nature. Same is the case with oxygen. Ma'am, if you take raw, ma'am, if you inhale raw oxygen, your bones will start to rust.
Who said that? Who said that means, where did you read that?
Ma'am, in my encyclopedia, I had read about it.
Okay. Can you just send me a photograph of it? I want to just understand what is written there. Because how can the bones rust with oxygen? Oxygen is continuously there in our body.
No, ma'am, I'm saying raw oxygen.
Yeah, raw oxygen. Raw oxygen is only there in our body. Raw oxygen is only there in body. There must be some other meaning to it. I just want to get that to you. So you just send me a photograph whenever you get time. So I can read it and let you know if what you are saying is correct or is there some other side to it. Okay?
Okay.
So generally mixtures keep their original properties. The properties will not change and you can separate the components very, very easily. We go to the next slide. Some examples of mixtures. Seawater, it's a mixture of various salts and water in it. So many salts are dissolved in it. I'm not talking about NaCl, okay? NaCl is one salt. There may be many other salts. For example, NaHCO3, sodium baking soda. That is also a salt. Okay, anything that is in a solid form, a compound, we call it as a salt. So that is a salt. I think you must have seen copper sulfate sometimes. CuSO4, blue color, crystal-like substance. That is also a salt. So that is, salt is just a general term given in chemistry to any compound that is formed. Okay. Then air. Air is a mixture of a lot of gases. Oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen.
Ma'am?
Noble gases. Yes.
Ma'am, is there any test to see which salt is which?
Yeah, there are lots of tests. As you go further, you will be having a practical to determine which salt is there. As in when you go further, 9th standard, 10th standard, 11th standard, 12th standard, there are practicals only to identify which salt is there. Okay. Then example of salad, I'd given you example last time of bhel. Those all are mixtures. Okay. Next. Next slide. We spoke homogeneous. Homogeneous mixtures are the ones that are present in components, but you can't identify it. So example, sugar or salt water, some colored water, because you mixed color and water into it. You can't see the particles of color and the particles of water separately. Or if you take any drinking chocolate, any milk, Bonvita, Horlicks, etc., you don't come to know that it is mixed inside it. Okay. Next would be a heterogeneous mixture. Next slide. So here, a very good example is given of cornflakes, salads, probably a variety of dry fruits you eat at home. That would be a heterogeneous mixture. Okay. Now we'll go to the next slide. This is just a revision of what I just did right now. Again, these are all examples of, you can identify the first two examples, the potassium permanganate in water and the salt in water. These both are homogeneous. And oil in water, not mixing, you can see both the things separately. So you will call it as a heterogeneous mixture. Similar way, there is oil, there is water, and there is sand on the left side. So this is again a heterogeneous mixture. Okay. So these are all examples of heterogeneous mixtures. Now, these methods of separation are the olden methods of separation that people were using at home. And today also we are using, today also a lot of farmers are using this. Okay. First example is hand picking. So I had told you all that you can take a variety of grains, like you can take rice, you can take you can wheat, you can take dals, and you can mix them. And then now you try to separate it with your hand. So normally people at home do it so that to remove any kind of dirt or any kind of stones or something that is probably got mixed into the grains that come into our house. So that method is called as hand picking. Hand picking can be done when you have a very less quantity. So you have got in your house probably say half a kg of rice. You can do it. You cannot carry hand picking on an industrial basis. You can't do that. Industrial basis, you can't do it. So these all are very home based kind of techniques, the hand picking method. Then we have got threshing. Threshing is a way to remove the wheat from the plant. So the wheat is actually a fruit. It's kind of a fruit on the plant, and that has to be removed. So what they do is they beat on something, and by beating it on something, that wheat gets separated out. So that is what we call as threshing. Okay. Winnowing is, I told you all to take some peanuts or some groundnut and remove the cover of it. And then what you do is you just, in your hands, like how this lady is catching and just moving both the hands, you know, left or right, you just blow it off with air. Basically, winnowing is done with the help of air. So what the air does is it carries the lighter particles away and the heavier particles remain in your plate or whatever material that you are making it fall from. So whatever is falling away in the picture is the lighter particles. The heavier particles stay in the basket, which is there on the head of the lady. Okay. Sieving is also another method if we want to sieve two different things. So I gave you one thing to do. Sieving and filtration would be a similar kind of a method. Okay. Sieving, basically what we are doing, trying to do is, we're trying to separate two different components on basis of their size. So a sieve that is there, that is a net that is there. So very good example, you all must be having nets in your house on the balconies or on the windows. Why do we put the nets? We put it so that the mosquitoes don't come. Now, if you see the size of the net, you get different sizes of net. You get very small size nets also for mosquitoes. You get a little bit bigger size nets, probably for lizards, a little bit more bigger nets. People put in the balcony so that the pigeons don't come inside. Okay, so depending on what material or what you don't want to pass, what things you want to pass, you use the particular kind of a sieve. Okay, so that sieve method and filtration is approximately the same. Okay, so these are the olden methods of filtration. I'm very sure you all must have studied it in school also. And if you all get time, please do carry out the hand picking and the winnowing method that we have told you all to do. Okay. Okay, next. Now we are separating a mixture of solid. Okay. Now we are coming to an industrial level, we're coming to a bigger level. Now we're not talking at home level. So if I have two solids, I can't do picking in an industry. Okay, so I have to apply some method. Now to apply some method, I need to know a certain property which will be there in one, which will make it different from the other. For example, in your class, there are so many students out there. Okay, so what the teacher will do, the teacher will say, okay, come on, now line up as per your height. So she is classifying you as your height. So the shortest will be in the front and the tallest will be at back. Or it could be vice versa. So whatever way. So you are differentiating things based on a property. So here the properties that we are using is going to be different depending on the material that is there inside our mixture. The first method is sublimation. So I will use sublimation when I know one of my components can sublime. Means what? When I heat the mixture, all the components are solid. So when you heat it, the solid will melt except one solid. That one solid will melt into liquid. It will evaporate into gas because it sublimes. We did sublimation also. So one of the component will sublime, the others will melt. So on that basis, all my other components will remain in my evaporating basin. So wherever, whatever container I'm doing, the other things will evaporate and get collected on some other place. Understood? So that would be my point of sublimation. Now the second method is solvent extraction. Solvent extraction method would be when I come to know that out of my two solids, one is soluble in something and one is not soluble in something. For example, if I have got salt and soil, okay, and I'm putting water into it, I know that salt will dissolve in water, but soil will not dissolve in water. So I've separated my two components. My soil will remain back down, but my salt will come into the water. Then I'll do whatever process I want to do with that salt water further. But I've separated both my solids. Magnetic separation. I will use magnetic separation when I know one of my components is magnetic. Like I told you, iron and copper. I know that iron will be attracted by magnet. Iron can get easily attracted by magnet. So very easily I have to just take a magnet and I have to just use it. So like we use this in the trash, what do people do? In the trash, the people are using big magnets to separate out all the metals from all the other non-metallic stuff, like plastic, wood, cloth, whatever has come into the trash, the metal parts are removed out so that they can be reused. They can
burn for. Sublimation?
Yeah, we are going to come to that. I'm just doing a brief of it right now.
Okay.
We're going individually to it.
Mama, I have a question. Let's say I have mixed iron and cobalt.
Hmm.
Or take nickel. Iron and nickel. Both of them are magnetic.
So then I have to use some other method. Then I know both my components are magnetic in nature, then I have to use some other kind of technique to separate them out. Okay? Okay, we'll go to the next slide. So we'll go into details of all these three methods. So we said, what is sublimation? Sublimation is when the solid directly goes into gas without passing in through the liquid state. That is what we call as sublimation. Correct? We did this last time. Okay? So it will not go to the liquid state, it will go directly to the gas state. Next. These are all the examples of sublimable solids. The naphthol balls, which I was talking about, or the dry ice, even iodine, camphor, the kapur that you use probably in your house, ammonium chloride is a chemical. These all are sublimable solids. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. That is the experimental form. So what happens is, below there is a china dish. In the china dish, I have kept a mixture of ammonium chloride and salt. Now, out of ammonium chloride and salt, I know ammonium chloride will sublime, but salt will not sublime. So when I've put a kind of a inverted funnel on top of this mixture and I'm starting to heat it, the salt will melt whatever was there in the mixture. So the salt out there will remain and it will become into liquid state. But the ammonium chloride will become gas and it will get deposit upside. Can you see on the upper side it is written solidified ammonium chloride. All of this ammonium chloride will get separated from the salt. So we know that salt and ammonium chloride is separated in two different things. This is how we use sublimation method. Understood? Is this method clear to you? The sublimation method as a separating mixture. Okay. Next.
Ma'am, I have a question. Like, if I mix ammonium chloride salt and then also salt, so will sublimation still work?
Yeah, that's exactly what we did in the previous. No, we took ammonium chloride and we took salt.
Oh.
Sodium chloride. We did that only, no? Was that clear to everyone or no?
Ma'am, can you go to the before slide? Because I can't remember, but there was something that you have to mix water and then you can separate those two. Will that work for ammonium chloride and salt?
No, it will not work for salt because ammonium chloride will also dissolve in water. Even normal sodium chloride will also dissolve in water.
Okay,
so we'll go to the second method, that is a magnetic separation. So here there's a mixture of two things, magnetic and non-magnetic. And I'm very easily using a magnet to separate the magnetic substances from the non-magnetic substances. Very easy method, not very complicated. We normally do it if we have a magnet at home. We like to go and, you know, mix things and then separate out the magnetic substances from the non-magnetic ones. Yes? Next slide. So here the example that we have done. Sulfur, and we have taken iron filings. Sulfur is again the element sulfur, and we've taken iron filings and we've mixed it. It is physically mixed. Now I'm just using a magnet. In the magnet, all the iron will come, the sulfur will remain down. So very easily I've separated both the things. Here the basis of separation is magnetism. So there has to be some property that is going to make the two things separate out. Okay. Now the third method. Now the third method is, like I discussed to you, we need two components out of which I know one component will not dissolve in the liquid that I'm adding. or in my solvent. So here I have taken sand and salt water mixture. On the left hand side you can see. The sand and salt water mixture, I have mixed it in water. So what happens, all the salt has gone into the water. All the salt has got mixed into the solvent that I have used. And the sand will remain down. The sand will just get deposited down. What I can do very easily, I can filter them out using a filter paper. All my sand will come into the filter paper and all the water will contain the salt. Now I need to either carry out distillation process or I can also do simply evaporation method. In the evaporation method, I have to just keep it in the sun or I have to keep it for boiling. All the water will get boiled out and all the salt will remain back. So easily I can use these two methods to separate these two solids. Okay, so these are the three methods. One was based on sublimation, one was based on magnetism, and one was based on the ability to dissolve in a solvent, the ability to dissolve in some liquid. Okay, now we'll go to the next. Now we're talking about a mixture of where one component is solid and one component is liquid. Out of that, one method we just discussed right now, filtration. We'll be doing it more in detail also. Filtration is when I've got some solid mixture that is not dissolved in the liquid, and I can very easily use a filter paper and I can separate the two components. Evaporation method is when the solid has got mixed into the liquid, so I cannot see it. What I need to do is I need to evaporate it, I need to boil it, so all the liquid gets evaporated off and the solid will remain back down. Sedimentation is when one of the solid that is there is very heavy. If it is heavy and it is not soluble, if it is heavy and insoluble in the liquid, so what will happen is that it will settle down. It will settle down, so we'll be able to remove the liquid and the solid components easily out. The next method is crystallization. I'll go into more details of it when we go to that slide. And then there is centrifugation. Again, I'll go to details of that when we go to that slide. Okay, we'll now go to the first filtration. No, first is sedimentation, then I think filtration comes in. Okay, so in the sedimentation, like we said, if I had told you all to take some soil and water, make a mixture of it and leave it for some time, for an hour or so, what you will observe is that the soil or the sand particles, they are not soluble in water. Because they are not soluble in water, and plus second part is that they are heavy, they are more dense than water. So they all will settle down. So here in the second picture, you can see that the sand has settled down and the water is floating on the top. Now, this method is called as sedimentation. It has sedimented. It has come down. So this method is sedimentation. Now what I do is very slowly and with precision, I just pick up my beaker and I am going to just pour off the liquid into some other container. This method is what we call as decantation. So normally sedimentation, decantation goes hand in hand. And both of them happen together. Okay. I think this method is clear. I think these are very basic techniques. I think you all must have done it in school or must have seen it somewhere. Or if not seen, probably whenever we meet next, you will be doing it for yourself. Okay, next slide. Now, we add sometimes alum, or in Hindi language, people use the word fitkari or something like that kind of material. I think they use some word like that. What that does is, the alum is acting like a coagulant. Coagulant is where you are able to get all the particles together with you and you let it settle down. So the alum is added to some kind of a sedimentation process so that the alum is able to trap up all the particles, all the impurities that are there, and make those impurities heavy. The impurities were light. So that is why they were floating. Now the coagulant has trapped all those impurities, so it has become heavy and now it will settle down. So it will make all these impurities settle down very, very fast. So we use alum as a coagulant. So if in that process of doing sedimentation you add alum also, if the sedimentation was taking time of say 1 hour, this will take half an hour time, plus the efficiency increases. The number of impurities that were to be dissolved or to be removed will increase much, much more by using an alum. Okay. So this is sedimentation. Means basically it is making the components sediment down, and we can make the process faster by using alum. Okay, or next. Filtration method, very easily. I told you to do it for the paneer method. You had to take milk, put a few drops of lemon into it. So what will happen is that the solids will separate out from the water. So we come to know that milk is actually a mixture. Milk is not a compound. Milk is a mixture of solids, solid components, that is the solid proteins, fats, and all of those solid components, and the water into it. Correct? So,
Mom, what do we have to put into the milk?
Lemon. You can put lemon or you can put vinegar. Anything that is sour. You can put any sour thing into it. So that those things will separate out. And then by using a muslin cloth or probably a handkerchief, you can filter it. Once you filter it, what will happen? The water will be collected below, which will be called as a filtrate. So whatever is coming down, we call it as a filtrate. And what remains on your handkerchief will be called as a residue. So it will become finally it becomes paneer. This is how paneer is made. From the milk, you separate out the solid components and then you filter them and you keep it some time in the fridge or something, and that becomes paneer. This is how the paneer is made. Okay, so this was one example which you all can try at home. We have given you a lot of examples so that you can do it at home, so you all are self busy, plus you all understand the things better. We had told you all to do this in advance so that when I was discussing this, it would have been easy for you all to understand the method. Okay, so this was a filtration process. And I will go to the next one. Evaporation. Like we had discussed, evaporation is different from boiling. Basically, evaporation is when you're just leaving it in the sun, you're letting the sun do the work. So it is just happening layer by layer. The upper layer first goes out, then the second layer goes, and the third layer goes. In the boiling, what happens is all the layers are together working together of the water. So in the evaporation method, what happens? The solid components will remain down, but the liquid components will evaporate out. The liquid components will go away. So this happens, I don't know if you all have any time seen it. It happens for making salt, the NaCl salt. So salt is easily available in seawater. So what they do is near the beach or wherever the salt production takes place, they make small rectangular or square kind of dams, you know, small bridges kind of thing, where they store the salt water for some. What will happen is all the water gets evaporated out and all the salt will remain down. Then that salt goes further for processing, cleaning and all that goes. But the basic salt procuration from the seawater is happening in this method, the evaporation method. For this also I told you, take a small cap of bottle. And in that bottle cap, put a little bit water and put little bit of salt. And just keep it in the sun for, say, 2 or 3 days. In that 2 or 3 days, you will observe that all the water will get evaporated out and all the salt particles will remain back into your cap. Please try this at home so you'll be able to understand the process of evaporation very, very well. Okay? We'll go to the next slide. So this was just a differentiation between the evaporation and the boiling. I told you evaporation is a surface phenomenon. Only the particles from the first surface that is exposed to air will start to evaporate out. So that's why it is a very slow process. Whereas boiling will happen right from the below particles also. All will start boiling together. It's a very fast process. But it requires energy. Evaporation does not require energy. That is why procuring salt is not a very tough job. You get it, first of all, you are using seawater, which is free of cost. You are not even using a lot of machineries for evaporating the water. So again, it's a very free process. Yes, the processing part of it would require some manpower or some machinery. Besides that, it is just a very normal process. So it is a easy and a very cost-free method. Okay, so that would be evaporation and boiling. Now we'll go to the next. So basically, what are crystals? First and that, what are crystals? Okay, so crystals are solids. Okay, but they are very ordered solids. So for example, if I have got a class, okay, and in that class, all the students are just doing masti and they're just running from one place to the other and you know, going to their friend and talking. How disordered manner would that look? I hope you all can email them to it. You all must be remembering your school time. So that would be a normal solid. Okay, that would be called a normal solid. Now, if supposing your teacher enters, what will happen? You all will go back to your places. You all will sit on your designated desk. You all will become very orderly manner again. So that is what is crystal. So the solid particles that are properly arranged, properly in their designated places, they are called as crystals. So, like you can see, the first picture, the red and the white color, they are all some elements, some or the other elements. Okay, those elements are there properly ordered in the way they are supposed to do. The properly way that they are supposed to be placed. So when they happen like that is what we call them as crystals. One structure is on the left side, on the right, on the middle one, from one it has become four such structures. From the other right side, from four it has become more than that also. Correct? So this is how crystallization takes place. So you start from one crystal, then that one crystal will become into many crystals. It is like attracting. It's like a magnetic kind of a force. Like, you know how magnet attracts the iron particles. That same way, these small crystals, they act as a nucleation. So we call the process nucleation. We always start crystallization with one particular crystal that acts as a magnet for the other crystals, only crystals to come in. So in that process, if my component, if my mixture has some other solids which are not the crystal category, they will not be attracted to my crystal that I had added. So it is like, you know, I have put a fish for a bait. If I put one fish, if I put for the fish, what do we use as a bait? Something that the fish eats, probably a small shrimp or something, or a smaller fish or something like that. So then the fish will come and get attracted to the bait. That same way, the bait that I'm using here is a crystal only. So for crystallization, I have to start from a crystal only. So I'll start from a crystal. That crystal will attract only the crystal, not any other solid particles. So all the dirt particles or whatever other things were there into my mixture will not come into my crystal that is finally being formed. So this is how I'm separating, this is how I'm using crystallization as a method of separating two solids. So it will be depending. Okay, wait. Let's go to the next slide. So probably I think you may be able to understand. So here, if you can see on the left hand side, I have got a beaker that contains a certain solution. Okay, which I've kept for boiling. Okay, after boiling, what do? Is I am trying to filter it. So all the dirt particles that were there in my substance, in my mixture, is coming out because of filtration. Now there may be some particles which were still there undissolved. Which are there dissolved inside it. So if I want to remove the dissolved particles, I have to use a method which is called as crystallization. When will I use crystallization? When I know that one of my particles in the crystallization is a crystal. So have you seen ever the salt in a microscope, or probably have you seen big crystals of sugar? Have you seen big crystals of sugar?
Sometimes in
the market you get small also. Sometimes in the market you get big crystal particles also of sugar.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now what happens is that if I had got sugar mixed with some other thing, okay, some other component. Let's say sugar was mixed with, let's say baking soda, for example, okay? Let's say sugar was mixed with baking soda. Now, both of these things were soluble in water, correct? Both of them were soluble in water. But I want to separate out my sugar. So what do? Is I am going to make a very concentrated solution of that particular mixture. So I'm going to let it boil for some time so it gets very, very concentrated. Once it gets concentrated, I am going to filter it so that if there is any dirt particles or anything, that will also go off. Now, still in my solution, in that concentrated solution, I still have sugar also. I still have baking soda also. Now, how to remove both these things? So I know baking soda is never going to be crystal. Baking soda is like those naughty children. Okay. They will never form crystals. So they are called as amorphous solids. They will always be in a disordered manner only. They can never get in an ordered manner. But I know my sugar particles are very good children and they will become those orderly manner and they can form crystals. So what I do is once I filter that solution, that hot solution, I am now going to put one drop or probably one crystal into that solution of sugar. So now that sugar, that orderly mannered sugar that I put, that one small part of it, is going to attract all the other sugar particles that are there in my mixture solution. So all the other orderly particles of sugar will come and start sticking to it. So it's like attracting, you know, same things come and attract to each other outer. So all my sugar particles will come and will form a big lump of sugar. So can you see all these crystals on the top? Can you see all these different colored crystals? The orange color, the blue color. They all will form different as per their element. Okay, so my sugar is white color. Other element may be orange color. A diamond is again transparent white in color. So depending on different elements, they will catch different colors. Okay, and what happened to my baking soda? Where did it go? It remained in my solution. So this way I separated out the baking soda solid from the sugar solid. Is this clear now? Was crystallization clear?
Yes, ma'am. So I was asking that. So, ma'am, so diamond is made from the crystallization of carbon, right?
No, diamond is not made from crystallization of carbon. Diamond is naturally available. Okay, we can't make diamond. Okay, diamond is very much naturally available. If supposing we could make it from crystallization, diamond. You did not understand anything of it?
No, ma'am.
You did not understand anything?
No, ma'am.
Did you understand that solids are of two types? One is a crystalline form and one is another form.
Yes, ma'am.
Understand that? Okay. So the other form name, I was not giving you all because I didn't want to confuse you all, but you all can say the other form was called as amorphous. Amorphous. Okay. So we have got amorphous solids and we have got crystalline solids. Okay. Amorphous solids are the one that is disordered. And crystalline solids are ones that are in an orderly manner. Okay. Now what happens is, I have got a mixture of a crystal and an amorphous substance. I've got two components. Now I know that they are not magnetic. I know that they are not even sublimable. I know that both of them are dissolving in water. So I can't use any of these three techniques. Correct? So now what am I going to do? What I will do is I will use a method that is called as crystallization. So in using the method of crystallization, what am I going to do is I'm going to use one crystal. I'm going to use one particular crystal as a start of the reaction, as a start of the base formation. For what bait formation? I'm going to make the bait formation for the process so that all my crystals that are there in the solution stick up to it. They all get stick up to it and only the non-crystalline substances will remain back into the solution. Can we go to a slide before this, the blue color one? So here on the left-hand side, you can see that there is copper sulfate solution. That copper sulfate had got copper sulfate, which is a crystal. Okay. Along with that, there were also some other amorphous substances mixed into it. Now what I do is, I start to take one crystal and I put it into this solution. Now this will start to attract all the crystals that were there dissolved in the solution. So slowly on the right hand side, can you see the crystal size has increased? The crystal size has become very, very big now. The crystal size has become big. Why? Because all the crystalline solid copper sulfate particles that were there, copper sulfate compound which was there, had got attracted to my initial one particular crystal that I kept. So that process is called as nucleation. We kind of like a bait, like I gave you an example, like a fishing bait. So it is like a bait that I'm putting, the nucleation, and that will start the reaction, and all the crystals that are there in the solution, that all crystalline solids will get attracted and to become into a very big, very, very big crystal solid. Okay. So for this, you can actually try a method at home. Lot of time, that's why I had not given it to you as the homework is, you can make a crystal candy. You can make a sugar candy. So to make a sugar candy, what you do is, you will take sugar and make a thick solution of sugar. So the right quantity is required. So it's like 1 cup of sugar will require, no, 3 cups of sugar and 1 cup of water. There is a particular quantity. I will message it to you later. Then you keep it for a boil for like 2 to 3 minutes. Okay. And then what? You take a stick, you dip it, you make it wet, and you dip it in crystals, sugar crystals. Okay. And then you now put it into this solution. So what will happen? All the sugar that you had dissolved will start to attract to these sugar crystals. They will attract to these sugar crystals, and you will get a crystal sugar candy. You will get. Yes.
Ma'am, can yes. you post the method of crystallization on the group?
Okay, we'll do it. Okay, so I'll go to the next topic now, because still a little bit left to be done. The next method is centrifugation. Centrifugation is nothing but sedimentation, but with the help of a machine. So what really happens is, what starts to happen is that in a mixture, there are a lot of components which will take a lot of time to sediment. So if I had told you all that you need to sediment soil and water, if you are going to sediment soil and water, it will take 1 hour to sediment the soil and water. But if I do the process of centrifugation, it will happen within seconds. So what is the method required here is, I don't know, anytime if in, you know, just in lay, you must have done it. You must have taken a ball, attached it to a string, and just gone, you know, round with it. So what will happen, the ball will try to pull you outside. The ball will try to go and escape outside. Why? It is because of the, it is called as a force. There is a centrifugal force that is acting out there. So the centrifugal force is trying to separate components out on based of their densities. So we very
breaking.
Huh?
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Okay. Now can you hear me?
No, ma'am, it's still breaking.
My voice is breaking.
Yes, ma'am.
Now is my voice breaking? Now?
Now it's a little bit clear.
Breaking. Now it's clear.
Okay. So what happens is, we use this for blood. I'm very sure all of y'all must have gone for blood test or sometime. Do this on the left side. Can you see this blood out there? They will take the blood and they will put it into a small vial. Okay. And then that vial, what they do is they put it into a machine here. So what happens to that machine? On the left side, there's a small GIF given to you to show that what happens in the machine. That machine is going to go round and round and round and round. It will totally turn round and round and round. So because of that round and round motion, that force is created, and because of that force, all blood components will separate out. So blood consists of plasma and it contains of cells. All those plasma and cells will separate out. So then your blood, whatever test has to be done further, they do it. If they require plasma, they will do the plasma test. If they require the red part of the blood, the cells, they will use the red part of the cells for the test.
Ma'am, I have a question, like, which state of matter is plasma?
Plasma is liquid. Here, the blood plasma is liquid. The other plasma that you're talking about is another state of matter. We've not gone into it right now. Okay. Is centrifugation clear with you all?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now we'll go to the third type. Next. Next slide. Now we're going to the liquid-liquid mixture. Liquid-liquid mixtures we can separate out by three methods. One is a separating funnel, one is distillation, and the third method is chromatography. Okay, I'm very sure all three of these names are new to you all, so I'm going to go to the slide only and then start the explanation of it. Okay, so we'll go to the first method, that is your separating funnel. Next slide. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Now.
Yes, ma'am.
I think Swapna ma'am sees there's some issues. She'll come back with the presentation. So the first method that we're talking about is going to be the separating funnel. So that basic example we have seen is because of the density, two things are getting are not mixing,
is my,
for example.
Is my screen visible now?
Not still. Yeah, now it's visible. Yeah. So the separating funnel is exactly what is given here. So supposing I have got liquids which are not miscible with each other, they are immiscible liquids. Best example is water and oil. So what will happen is, we know that oil floats on water. Oil is more denser than oil is less denser than water. Water is more denser. So the water will be in lower portion of separating funnel. So now, can you see there is a small top cock is there, a small tap is there. So see, you can see in the GIF, they have put a mixture of water and they've put a mixture of oil. After some time, what happens? Water and the oil is taking its own position depending upon its density. Now, I will start the stopcock. So what will happen is, all my water, which is there first, will be collected in a separate or in a different container. See that now water is completely over, and I'm getting to see that now oil will start. I have to stop the cork. The minute I stop the cork, I will get only oil in my separating funnel, that I can remove it separately. So by using this, I am separating the oil and I'm separating the water. So that is why this method is called as separating funnel. It is acting like a funnel to separate out both the liquids. This is used only and only for liquids. You can't use it for a solid and a liquid. Okay? Clear? Is this separating funnel clear? Very easy to understand. I'm very sure by seeing the GIS, you all must have understood how to do it. We'll go to the next. Now, the next will take a little bit time to understand. Hold on, okay? Now, if any time, have you seen that your pen is, suppose you put it in on a tissue paper and then you and water drops on it, it will start to blot out. It will blot out. It will, you know, spread out. So what happens is, in the chromatography, you are separating the components based on their size. Okay, so here if you can see, my mixture has different sized components. I have got those yellow colored rounds. I've got the red colored rounds. I have got the blue colored squares, and I've got some black colored dots also. So I have got all these components. So that is there in my one of my phase, which I call as my stationary phase. So what do I do is, I am going to put it on a particular phase. Let's say I'm going to put it on a paper. Okay, once I put it on a paper, and then I have to let some liquid component run into it. So that is called liquid phase. So that liquid component I let it go is sometimes ethanol, or it may be sometimes water, or it may be ether, depending on what I am separating out. The components that were there in the mixtures, according to their weight, will travel. This is going anti-gravity. When I'll go to the next slide, you'll understand. They're going anti-gravity. So when they're going anti-gravity, the ones that are more heavier will remain down, and the ones that are less heavier will climb up. Very good example this I'll give you is, have you all any time climbed the wall, that rock climbing? Have you all done rock climbing?
Yes, ma'am. I've done this one.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Do you realize the more lighter you are, easier it is for you to climb till the top of it? And if you're a little bit more heavier, you will not be able to take your weight because you're going vertically upwards. You're going anti-gravity. So what will happen is, the ones that are heavier, say supposing you start, kids can go more faster up. Their parents will not be able to go even halfway through also, if the parents and the kids doing it together. Okay? So the more heavier the weight, it's difficult to climb up. That same kind of method is done here. So we'll go to the next slide, you'll understand it. See, here the mixture was there. I had kept it on the left side. Can you see on a paper, I've kept the mixture here.
Ma'am,
okay. And then,
ma'am, I didn't understand this because my network was lost.
Okay. So there is a mixture that is kept on a paper out here on the left hand side. Okay. Where that it is written ink. Okay. All that mixture is there. Now I'm putting it vertically straight. I'm letting water run. So what will happen as the water will run, as the water will be absorbed up, as the water is going up and up and up, okay, according to their weight, according to their ability to go up and up higher, they will get separated out. So you can see those black color, blue color dots are down, then there are red color, and then there are yellow color. So all the components will be separated out. So very easy thing to do for this is, I don't know, you all have any time to get it out or no, black ink, or you basically, you can try with a black color sketch pen. Put a dot of a black color sketch pen on a tissue paper. Okay. Then put a drop of water or put 2 to 3 drops of water on that. What will happen that that drop of water will spread out. As it is spreading out and out, all the different colors, the black color will separate out. So you will see a ring of red, you will see a ring of purple, you will see a ring of yellow, you will see a ring of blue. So that is how you come to know that the black color actually had all these colors also into it. So that is why it is called as chromatography. Chrome basically means color. So when you're separating these colored components, we call it as chromatography. We normally don't use it daily. We don't use it. It is used for very scientific, highly scientific purposes. There are a lot of type of chromatographies available. Okay. We do it for DNA also. For DNA analysis, they use chromatography. Okay. Next. So can you see how this happened? The red ones remained at a certain level. The green one went ahead. So the red ones stopped as per their ability to go higher up. The green one went more higher. So we are separating the colored components. That is why it is called as chromatography. Next. So you can see how you saw how did it go up. So the red had the ability to go till certain level. The green went a little bit more higher, went much, much higher. You can see it once more. This is my paper. I put different components. I have put it in water. The water is carrying the components up. The ones that had the ability to go higher up went up. The ones that could not remain down. Okay, so this is what is basically chromatography. You can see it once more. Then there are various ways to calculate the components being separated. This is very detailing. I've just given picture of it. If you can understand well and good, not understood, it is not required for you. We calculate a factor that is called as retention factor or a RF factor. What is that? We see that how, which component has traveled up and the total travel of the liquid. So, for example, the red has traveled up to, say, 10 centimeters. And the water ran all the way 20 centimeters. So then I'll do 10 divided by 20. That will come as 1 upon 2. That will become 0.5. So the RF factor for the red color would be 0.5. This is just an example. Okay. So when you are doing this chromatography, you use RF. You get different RF values for the different components that are there into the mixture. Okay, next. Now the next process is the distillation process. In the distillation, what happens is, for example, I've got, in the beginning, when we saw, we said that using distillation also, salt and water. If I've got salt and water, I've put it in the distillation flask on the left-hand side. What will happen at the boiling point? The water will start boiling, okay, but the salt will not boil. The salt will remain back. Okay, at the boiling point, the water will start to boil. Salt will not boil. The salt will remain in the flask. All the water will get converted into vapors. Those vapors pass into condensation tube, that is a blue color tube, because of which the vapors hit a cold surface. The minute it hits into a cold surface, the vapors get converted back into liquid. So basically you are doing liquid to gas, then again back to liquid. But in that process, you have purified it. So this process is what we call as distillation. Okay? Distillation is when we are able to separate the solid components from the liquid component. Okay? So we use distillation process for making distilled water. I'm very sure you all must have seen batteries at home in your inverters, or probably batteries in your cars. And, you know, you all put only distilled water into it. You don't put the normal tap water into it. Why is it so? Because if those tap water or the normal Bisleri water, if you put into it, what would happen is that all the dissolved salts that were there in the water will get deposited on the battery, and it will spoil the battery. So what we do is we use distilled water. So that what we do is we take the water and we put it into the distillation flask, and all the dissolved salts will remain back in the flask. Only the water will be separated out and be purified. And that water is what we called as distilled water. Okay? So this is what we call as simple distillation. Understood? Next slide. This is exactly how the assemblies, which was there in the previous one also. You can see left side, there's distillated flask. We put a thermometer there to know the temperature at which the liquid is distilling. Once it starts to distill, when it starts to evaporate, it will go into the condenser tube. The condenser will carry it all the way down, so that by the time it's down to the condenser tube, those vapors have got again converted into liquid. And that liquid will now become your distilled liquid. So it is a pure and purified liquid. Okay. Now next one is a distillation method. The more advanced distillation method. The next slide. This is what we call distillation. It's able to out different liquids at the same time. They fill up the liquids based on their difference in boiling points. So this is what is done for petroleum. So crude from the
Parita, it's not audible, huh? It's breaking quite a lot.
On the left side, you can see crude oil. The crude oil is heated, and once it is heated, according to its different temperatures, so the one that is more lighter, the one that is very, very light, that boils out 20 degrees also, will reach all the way till the top. The one that is little bit boiling after it at 70 degrees will distill out at the second level. Then naphtha boils out at 120, will come out at the third level. Kerosene again boils out at 170, comes at the fourth level. Diesel from the crude oil is coming out at 270, will come out from 270. and so on further, the lubricating oil, fuel oil, and the last one, the one that it's at 340 degrees, will come out from the last one, the bitumen, the last remaining part of the crude oil. So this is what is called as fractional distillation. You are separating components in fractions because of difference in the temperatures very easily. So in one go itself, you do the whole process. You don't have to do it separately. Okay? So you are able to go from small molecules to large molecules. The small molecules coming out on the higher side and the larger molecules coming out on the lower. Okay. Last slide now we'll go. So differentiation between the normal distillation and the fractional distillation. The fractional the simple distillation is a very simple process. You can have very easily. The fractional distillation is a more difficult setup, but it provides you better separation. Okay. On the simple distillation, the separation may not happen very well, but the fractional distillation is a very easy way to do it. It is, though it is complicated, it takes more time also, but still it is a better efficient method. And normally simple distillations we do in laboratories, in big industries where you're doing simple, just two or three components separation. But when you're going to more complex molecule separation, what we follow is fractional distillation method. Okay. So this is basically the difference between a simple distillation and a fractional distillation process. Okay. And with this, we end our separation of mixtures. I hope you have noted down at each level the different methods and the different properties required to separate out the mixtures.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Any questions? Any doubts? We've seen the doubts. Consequently, ma'am? Only. Yes.
Ma'am, can you tell all the science experiment we have to do last?
Let's send you a PDF now of all the.
Mom, I didn't understand centrifugation.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, Farida, are you there?
Ma'am just left the meeting.
Okay, so centrifugation basically, as ma'am said, is to separate out the components which are dissolved in a liquid based on their size, shape, density, and the viscosity. Viscosity means how sticky your solvent is. You all know what is a solvent and a solute, right? So blood is a component. Blood is a mixture of various components. The liquid, the base, is called the plasma. And the solid components are red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, etc. Now, when you have to separate, so for performing various laboratory tests, you have to at times separate out the components of the blood. So you cannot use any other separation techniques here because it's not just one solid which is dissolved. So what you do is you separate out, or you do a method called centrifugation, by which the different solids which are dissolved in that liquid, they get arranged in some orderly manner. So what you do is, you can look at the picture here. You take the blood sample in a test tube, you seal the test tube, you assemble the test tube in a assembly shown here, and then at a high speed, you let the test tubes rotate. So eventually what happens is, the blood which was earlier appearing like this gets formed or arranged, the components get arranged in this manner. And then using a syringe and a needle, you can extract whichever component you want to test. If you want to test RBC, you will inject your needle right to the RBC, you will take out only RBC or the platelets or the WBC likewise. Farida ma'am is back, not yet. Okay, any other doubts? Yeah, you're back.
Mom, she's on mute.
Okay. Farida, please, you can take it.
Machine used in centrifugation.
It's called a centrifugation machine only. And it works on a principle of physics which is called as centrifugation. You can Google it out and find out. Apart from this, it is used in your dairy industries also, like the Amul factory where milk is packaged and pasteurized and packaged. In many other industry, we use centrifugation techniques.
Okay. Any more doubts, kids?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so we end the session today. Please do all the activities that were given to y'all in the group before. There are some two or three activities more which I'll add more, and do send us your pictures.
Ma'am, I didn't get the activities. I didn't get the activities, ma'am.
Okay, we'll send it.
The last time activities about sedimentation filtration that I had sent last time.
Yeah, we'll send it to you once more again. Okay.
Ma'am, I'm not on the group. We have to send it privately.
Okay, we'll do that.
Yes, Shanvi, I'll send it to you.
Okay, and ma'am, you haven't given us the topics for our model.
Yeah, Janvi will discuss this after the class.
Okay. Thank you, students. Bye.
Bye, ma'am.
Take a break.
Bye, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.